The sight and sound of the deadly Junkers 87 Stuka Divebomber as it screams towards its target. In World War II, the Stuka struck fear into the hearts of millions. No other warplane became so instantly recognizable, and no other warplane was a more effective instrument of precision attack. For the German commanders, it was their flying artillery. The Stuka was not solely valued for its ability to cause destruction and death. Equally important was its capacity to inspire terror in the hearts of an enemy. Hitler had used terror to seize and hold power in Germany, and no one understood better the use of terror in the pursuit of invasion and conquest. The small, single-engined Junkers monoplane was the perfect instrument of terror, and has become the most chilling and enduring image of Nazi militarism. Wherever Hitler sent his armies, in Europe, in Africa, in Greece, the Balkans, and deep into Russia, these fearsome dive bombers were always in the forefront. It is surprising to note that although thousands were built, less than 400 of the aircraft were ever in service at any one time. Despite their relative scarcity, the Stuka was to leave an impression on World War II out of all proportion to its numbers. Soaring above the claims of the more glamorous types, it is the Stuka that has become synonymous with the German Luftwaffe. This is the last surviving Stuka in Western Europe. Of all those hundreds of planes, this single machine, lying peacefully at rest in the RAF Museum at Hendon, is the last of its kind on the continent to which it once spelled terror for millions. The men who fought against the Stuka would recognize instantly the angular, gull-winged shape. Those who flew in them forever held the aircraft dear to their hearts. First flown in 1935, the Stukas were already considered obsolete by the start of the war only 4 years later. But their commander, General Lieutenant Wolfram von Richthofen, was confident that his warplanes would prove their worth. Originally one of the many opponents of the dive bomber concept, Richthofen had been deeply impressed by the lethal accuracy of the handful of dive bombers available to the German Condor Legion in the Spanish Civil War. So, the Stukas were given a reprieve which was to last the whole 6 years of the war. The overriding advantage of the Stuka was the accuracy of its bombing run. Conventional bombers of the time released their bombs at high altitude. Aiming devices were rudimentary and accuracy was necessarily poor. dive bombers swooped down on their targets and guided their bombs towards the target, allowing far greater accuracy. With the special dive brake supplied, the Stuka could fly so low before pulling out of its dive it could almost place the bomb on the target, and its cranked wings allowed excellent forward vision. But there was one major disadvantage. The Stuka was very slow and cumbersome. It was almost defenseless against modern fighters such as the Spitfire or the Hurricane. Time and again, this great weakness would come back to haunt the German Air Force. Even by the exacting standards normal for aerial combat, the men who flew the Stukas had to be exceptionally fit. Coming out of a dive, the two crewmen were subjected to a centrifugal force up to 5 times that exerted by gravity. Blood was drained from the retina and brain, usually leading to a temporary blindness and loss of consciousness. It was found that short, stocky pilots in their 30s and 40s were best able to withstand the high G-forces involved in a dive bomb attack. To combat the disastrous possibilities of the crew losing consciousness, the Stuka was fitted with an automatic pull-out and bomb release mechanism, which prevented loss of control during this critical part of the dive bombing maneuver. In other respects, the controls were surprisingly simple. Early versions had only 2 instruments, a compass and a turn and bank indicator. Slowed down by the fixed undercarriage, top speed was less than 250 miles an hour. The Stuka was armed with 2 fixed-forward machine guns and a 3rd rear-facing gun operated by the navigator, who sat with his back to the direction of travel. The Stuka carried either a single 1,000-kilo bomb under the fuselage or 1 500-kilo bomb plus 4 smaller bombs under the wings. Strong German forces had been assembling clandestinely on the borders of Germany and East Prussia. Hitler's surprise attack on Poland, codenamed Operation White, was about to commence, and with it, the Second World War. Overhead, 200 fighters, 650 bombers, and over 200 Stukas flew eastwards through the dawn skies. It was 3 Stukas from 3 Stuka Geschwader 1 which dropped the first bombs of the war at Dürschau. It was a Stuka of STG-2 which first shot down an enemy plane. The prime objective of the Luftwaffe was to destroy the small Polish air force, on the ground if possible, in order that the Stukas and medium bombers could carry out their deadly work unimpeded. By the end of the first day, the Luftwaffe had lost 14 aircraft. The Poles had lost half of their air force. The Luftwaffe commanded supremacy in the air, and the Stukas were able to range with impunity, attacking the Polish communications, rail and road links, supply depots and relief columns. As the Germans advanced, they built improvised airstrips, allowing the Stukas to operate from close behind the front line. All leading army units were accompanied by Luftwaffe liaison officers in direct radio contact with their aircraft. This sophisticated level of cooperation between Army and Air Force was unique to the Germans and proved devastatingly successful. Besides the Stukas, the Germans also used a number of old Henschel HS-123 dive bomber biplanes. They knew that the harsh, high-pitched snarl from the Henschel's engine could also create fear amongst those on the ground. The Germans quickly found that by bombing towns and villages, the hordes of civilian refugees crowding back from the front seriously interfered with the movement of Polish forces. The object was not destruction, but terror. Warsaw was already encircled by the Germans. The Polish defenders put up a fierce but hopeless resistance. A prolonged, ferocious bombardment by heavy artillery and from the air left buildings of the capital in ruins and the streets littered with the dead. On the 29th of September, all resistance in Warsaw ended and Poland as a state ceased to exist. A new word was added to the English language, Blitzkrieg. German mastery of the powerful new technique of Blitzkrieg, lightning war, gained Hitler a dazzling triumph, and opinion was unanimous that throughout the campaign, Richthofen's Stukas had made a contribution far disproportionate to their numbers. The cost in military terms had been light. 31 aircraft lost, mainly through gunfire. The victory parade was followed by a lavish distribution of medals and promotions. Göring, the Luftwaffe commander, basked in new glory. By any standards, the Luftwaffe's rise from a clandestine organization in 1933 to supremacy in 1940 was a remarkable feat. Banned by the Treaty of Versailles from building warplanes in Germany, Junkers, Messerschmitt, Heinkel and Dornier had built factories abroad. The Junkers 87 was first penned in 1933 by Hermann Pohlmann. The distinctive inverted gull wings allowed the shortest undercarriage to reduce drag. Winning a dive bomber design competition in January 1935, the first prototype had taken to the air in September 1935, powered ironically by a Rolls-Royce V12 Kestrel engine. By the outbreak of war, the 87B1 boasted a 1,100 hp UMO 21 engine, and the cumbersome undercarriage fairings had been replaced by lightweight spats. After Poland, Hitler now had to deal with Britain and France, who had spurned his offers of peace. He was impatient to strike down France as soon as possible, but the German armed forces needed time in which to reorganize and build up their strength. The projected attack on France, codenamed Yellow, was repeatedly postponed. In the ensuing months, the Stuka squadrons were honed to a new perfection of battle readiness. The aura of glamour which the aircraft had acquired guaranteed that there was no shortage of volunteers anxious to fly in it. On May the 9th, 1940, the Western Front erupted. As Operation Yellow began, the Germans had thoroughly analyzed the successes of the Polish invasion, and the art of Blitzkrieg had been raised to a state of ruthless proficiency. A central tenet of Blitzkrieg was the sudden deployment of overwhelming force where it was least expected by the enemy. Germans had learned the effect produced by the mere sound of a dive bomber going into attack, and Stukas were now fitted with sirens, soon to be known as the Trumpets of Jericho. Perhaps no device in the history of warfare was so simple yet instilled such paralyzing fear. The high-pitched shriek unnerved even some of the Germans. It was heard above the cries of the wounded and the crash of explosions. The French troops were subjected to an ordeal beyond the limits of endurance. the Germans had established their bridgehead into France. With gathering momentum, the German armored spearheads drove westwards to the sea, wreaking havoc with the Allied communication and supply lines. The Stukas, operating with strong fighter protection, were again consistently to the fore, bombing, strafing, and harrying. The rapidity of the advance meant that the Stukas were flying from new, hastily constructed airstrips almost every day. Specially adapted trucks laid telephone cables at up to 20 miles per hour, keeping the new bases in touch with headquarters. Fuel and ammunition was brought in by continual relays of Junkers transports. Behind the Allied lines, all was confusion. The roads were choked with the fleeing, severely hampering the movement of British and French forces. Now, the mere sight of the Stuka's distinctive contours was enough to create panic. Recognizing the inevitability of defeat, the British resolved to evacuate their surviving troops from France. Stukas proved highly successful against Allied shipping, especially the smaller craft. But when bombs fell on the beaches, sand absorbed most of the blast. As Goring attempted to obliterate the British expeditionary forces on the beaches of Dunkirk for the first time, the Stukas encountered serious opposition in the air. The bulk of the RAF's fighter force had been conserved for the defence of Britain. Now, squadrons of Spitfires and Hurricanes flew across the channel to intercept the German bombers on their way to and from the Dunkirk beachhead. The British fighters could spend only a short time over France, but they did enough to expose the Stukas as alarmingly vulnerable when not well escorted by Messerschmitt fighters. By the 4th of June, the evacuation was complete. For the Germans, Dunkirk was an unplanned setback, but one far eclipsed by the splendor of their shattering victory over France, which formally capitulated on the 22nd of June. In Germany, the celebrations were long and jubilant, and the Stuka airmen were among the most feted of the heroes. The Stuka aces had become a glamorous new elite. Dr. Goebbels, Hitler's minister of propaganda, was quick to recognize the value of the Blitzkrieg victories, and soon German citizens were held enthralled by film vividly depicting the exploits of the Stuka squadrons and their intrepid pilots. The maker's original designation for the aircraft was the Junkers 87, and Stuka was simply an abbreviation of Sturkampfflugzeug, meaning dive bomber. But for friend and foe alike, the name Stuka became inexorably linked with one aircraft alone. On July the 16th, Hitler signed Führer Directive No. 16, laying down his plans for the invasion of England. The brunt of the initial fighting was to be borne by the Luftwaffe, which was assigned an onerous series of tasks. Among the first of these was to overwhelm British coastal defences and to close the channel to British shipping. Later, airfields and other targets further inland were to be struck. Goring's 2nd and 3rd Air Forces were based in France and Belgium, Their main adversaries were the Hurricanes and Spitfires of RAF Fighter Command. The Luftwaffe commanders were acutely aware of the relatively short range of their fighters. The deeper into Britain they had to penetrate, the shorter the time available for combat. The commanders hoped to destroy as much as possible of Fighter Command during the fighting over the Channel. On the 10th of July, the Channel battle began in earnest, when Stukas badly damaged two unwary Royal Navy destroyers. Over the next weeks, the trumpets of Jericho sounded often and loud. British coastal convoys were repeatedly hit, as was the destroyer base at Dover and other harbour installations. The Stuka pilots had all had specific practice in attacking shipping. Judging altitude above the sea was difficult, especially when the water was smooth. The Stuka pilot, forced to ditch in the sea, faced an unpleasant dilemma. Coming down in the water, the fixed undercarriage pulled the aircraft nose down violently, making death almost certain, whereas, if the crew bailed out, their raft and survival equipment was left in the cockpit. The resources of Fighter Command were stretched almost to breaking point, and Stuka losses were light compared with the damage they inflicted. By the end of July, the Admiralty was compelled to forbid destroyers to sail the Channel by daylight. What remained of the flotillas at Dover was moved to safer bases more distant from the Germans' proposed invasion area. The Stukas had fulfilled the role for which they had been designed. But Göring then made the fateful decision to employ them as a strategic, not tactical force against inland targets. It was a role for which they were manifestly unsuited. Against Fighter Command's Hurricanes and Spitfires, the Stukas were at a severe disadvantage. They were inferior in speed, ceiling, and armaments. Usually the cockpit was without protective armor. These weaknesses were well known to the British fighter pilots. During the Battle of France, Curtis Hawks of the French Air Force had encountered a formation of Stukas attacking a French armored column and had destroyed 16 of them. Now, whenever the Stukas were caught without a strong shield of accompanying fighters, the result was invariably a massacre. The RAF pilots relished nothing better than what they called a Stuka party. Throughout the first part of August, Stuka losses mounted at an appalling rate. On the 19th of August, on the personal orders of Hermann Göring, the dive bombers were withdrawn from frontline operations. The Stukas were moved to Pas-de-Calais area to rest and regroup in preparation for the coming invasion. To Göring's intense frustration, Fighter Command remained unbroken, forcing the cancellation of the invasion, and the Luftwaffe turned to the intensive bombing of British cities. The failure was also of grave concern to the Luftwaffe's commander of armaments, General Ernst Ude, an ace pilot from the First World War. Ude owed his important post to Hitler's patronage. Göring had long distrusted his capabilities, and for all Ude's charm, he proved to be a poor administrator. Göring himself was idle, and the two men were ill-equipped to prepare the Luftwaffe for the new challenges to come. Hitler was adamant that the war would soon be won, and with the existing weaponry. It had been Ude's admiration of the American Curtiss dive bomber which had prompted German development of a similar machine, but by 1940 the Stuka design was showing its age, and the Reich Air Agency originally intended to phase it out in early 1941. Even though the Stuka had sustained heavy losses during the Battle of Britain, by any standards it was an undeniable success. Stukas remained in production, and although a variety of improvements were incorporated into successive versions, the basic design remained unchanged. variations were produced to meet specific demands or conditions. A few 87B Stukas destined to work in ice-covered fields were fitted with skis. For desert conditions, the 87BR Trophisch had supercharger filters. The long-range 87R version, designed primarily for use against shipping, had two extra 300-litre tanks in place of the outer wing bomb load, and it had extra radio equipment. The Stuka's achievements impressed many in the Luftwaffe, and in consequence, the twin-engined Junkers 88 was adapted to operate as a dive bomber. Perhaps more remarkably, amongst other design changes, a dive bombing capability was even specified for the four-engined Heinkel 177. Amongst young German airmen, enthusiasm for the Stuka remained as strong as ever. Stuka aces, of which the most famous was Hans-Ulrich Rudel, became national heroes, and both men and machines were idolized. After Western Europe, the next great theater of conflict in which the Stuka displayed its lethal preeminence was the Mediterranean and North Africa. A strong Luftwaffe strike force, of which the Stukas formed a significant component, was transferred to Sicily and Romania in late 1940. This 10th Air Corps immediately commenced a running campaign of harassment against British convoys and warships. In a brilliantly planned and executed attack, Stukas crippled HMS Illustrious, the Royal Navy's only available aircraft carrier in the Mediterranean. Britain's previously assured domination of the Mediterranean was broken, and for 2 years, the eastern Mediterranean was effectively closed to British warships. Operations were confined to the so-called Stuka sanctuaries, areas out of reach of the aerial predators. Africa, Italy's entry into the war had resulted in an embarrassing series of defeats at the hands of the British and Commonwealth forces. In February 1941, General Rommel arrived in Tripoli with the first units of the Africa Corps. Almost immediately, Rommel took the offensive. His armed columns benefited immeasurably from the aggressive support provided by the Air Corps Africa, which included a contingent of 50 Stukas. The all-pervading desert sand presented both sides with formidable problems of aircraft maintenance. The difficulties were further compounded by the great extremes of temperature. The inevitable breakdowns often put more machines out of commission than enemy action. Most of the RAF fighters were still committed to the defense of the homeland, and for a time the Luftwaffe encountered limited resistance from them. Again and again, the desert air resounded to the malevolent wail of the dive bombers as the British forces were driven back eastwards in rapid retreat. A German general commented, "The British dread of the Stukas is equaled only by our soldiers' love for them." Africa Corps' surging advance left the strategic garrison port of Tobruk cut off and encircled. For weeks, repeated Stuka raids subjected the hapless defenders to a daily ordeal of terror until the British garrison finally surrendered. On the 6th of April 1941, Hitler launched a sudden invasion of Yugoslavia and Greece. 600 Luftwaffe aircraft, including two squadrons of Stukas, were deployed, and air opposition was negligible. The speed with which the German forces could be moved and made operational was still far beyond Britain's capabilities. The Stukas, protected by ME-109s, preyed upon villages, transport columns, railways, bridges, artillery, tanks, troops, and defenses. The cumulative effect was devastating. After 12 days of blitzkrieg, Yugoslavia was finished. Greece lasted until the end of May. The 60,000 strong British and Commonwealth reinforcements were hurriedly evacuated to Crete, which itself succumbed shortly thereafter to a dramatic airborne assault. Throughout the evacuations, the British ships were harried mercilessly from the air. The four squadrons of Hurricanes were soon overwhelmed, and Stukas claimed the troopship Slamet and the destroyers Diamond and Rhinic. 260 died on the cruiser Orion. With Crete secure, Stukas and bombers launched a punishing aerial offensive against Malta, Britain's last major Mediterranean fortress, and against convoys attempting to supply the beleaguered island. With only a handful of elderly Hurricanes to contend with, the Stukas, with fighter support, were able to bomb at will. In 1942, Malta endured 150 successive days of continuous bombing. In North Africa, the bitter struggle continued. But with the threat of invasion of Britain now lifted, RAF fighters were arriving in the desert in ever-increasing numbers, and it became too dangerous for the vulnerable Stukas to continue operations as before. The speed and distance of Rommel's advance left the Luftwaffe with huge logistical problems with fuel supplies. Many aircraft were transferred from the Mediterranean for more important work elsewhere. The Afrika Korps fought on with unabated vigor, but without effective air cover, its fate was already sealed. Allied ground and air strength eventually grew overwhelmingly, and the Afrika Korps was comprehensively defeated in October 1942 by Montgomery's 8th Army at the Battle of El Alamein. The final defeat of the Axis forces in Africa paved the way for the Allied invasions of Sicily and Italy. Before these events unfolded, however, Hitler's forces had been assigned a task of magnitude far exceeding anything so far attempted. Operation Barbarossa was aimed at overthrowing Stalin's Soviet Union. Germany's giant eastern neighbor had territory straddling 1/6 of the Earth's land surface. The vast bulk of these lay far out of the range of any of Göring's aircraft. Hitler's Directive No. 21 instructed the Luftwaffe first to eliminate the Red Air forces and thereafter to provide ground support for the German army. For this stupendous enterprise, Hitler amassed over 3 million men, but the total number of warplanes available was somewhat less than that assigned for the campaign against France a year previously. At 3 p.m. on the morning of June the 22nd, 1941, Operation Barbarossa commenced. Stalin had ignored the warnings of Hitler's intentions, and the Soviet forces were caught not only by surprise, but hopelessly ill-prepared. 70% of Soviet frontline aircraft were massed on airfields near the frontier, many lined up wingtip to wingtip, offering perfect targets. The Luftwaffe Stukas and bombers achieved their most extraordinary success ever. By the end of the first day, 1,811 Soviet aircraft had been destroyed, nearly all of them on the ground. Within 1 week, the toll had risen incredibly to over 4,000. The Germans lost only 35 planes. In Berlin, Göring refused to believe the statistics. Hitler, in his command bunker in East Prussia, received the reports from the front with mounting excitement. The land offensive was also proceeding astonishingly well. Under the shattering impact of the German Blitzkrieg assault, the Soviet defenses were reeling in disarray. With air superiority emphatically established, the Stukas reverted once more to their well-practiced role of tactical support, screaming down to obliterate target after target ahead of the fast-moving German armored spearheads. The landlines on which the Soviet military depended heavily for communications were also singled out for punishment. The most dramatic progress was made by the army driving from Moscow. The collaboration of tank and dive bomber was efficient and lethal as never before. The Luftwaffe liaison officers equipped with UHF radio played a major part in numerous attacks, and time after time the Stukas were called down to swing the balance in the Germans' favor. Throughout the autumn, the advance continued. The Germans took prisoners by the hundreds of thousands and destroyed or captured immense quantities of Soviet guns and tanks. Although, disturbingly, the Red Army seemed to possess inexhaustible reserves of men and machines. Although their loss rate was low, the Luftwaffe had never had to fight a campaign of such sustained duration. The combination of mechanical wear and tear with prolonged attrition began to cut deep into the fighting strength, and the sources of supply were ever lengthening. Stuka pilots had no defined tour of duty, and crews were flying six or more missions a day for weeks on end. Worse was to come. The first frosts were welcomed, as firming up ground made swampy by autumn rains. Operation Typhoon, the great final onslaught on Moscow, was able to get underway, but the temperature continued to fall. The freezing Russian winter was a certainty for which the Germans were inexcusably unprepared. High explosive bombs no longer detonated, but merely shattered on impact. Metal buckled and snapped. Ground crew, continuously at risk of frostbite, were driven to desperate measures to keep the aircraft functioning. The engines had to be started and warmed up at least every 30 minutes. As the offensive ground to a halt and the Luftwaffe struggled to keep flying in the intense cold, the Luftwaffe's director of armaments, Ernst Uday, slid deeper into alcoholism and depression. He had for long felt increasingly inadequate for the pressures of an office for which he was manifestly unfitted. It was now plain that there would be no blitzkrieg victory in the East. The shortcomings of the Luftwaffe's aircraft in a lengthy war of attrition were starkly visible. That November, whilst in a drunken stupor, Ernst Uday, the man who gave Germany the dive bomber, took a revolver and shot himself. By superhuman efforts, despite the atrocious conditions and fierce Soviet counterattacks, the German forces survived the winter, but precious time had been lost. Moscow was now well defended, and the chance of capturing Stalin's capital was lost. The Germans had encircled Leningrad, but the defenders received valuable artillery support from the heavy guns of the Baltic fleet riding at anchor. The Stukas were ordered in to attack the ships, and Hans-Ulrich Rudel succeeded in scoring a direct hit on the battleship Marat, with a new armor-piercing bomb tailing off the bows of the 23,000-ton vessel. By his great courage, diving faster and lower than anyone else in the force, through ferocious anti-aircraft fire, Rudel was able to add a battleship to the fantastic tally of tanks destroyed by this fearless aviator. In 1942, the major German military effort was switched to the south in the Caucasus, where Hitler hoped to cut off Stalin's supplies of oil. Although huge tracts of territory in the Crimea were taken, greater resistance was encountered than had been anticipated. For many weeks, the Germans lay siege to the great fortress port of Sebastopol. Naturally, Stukas were called upon to take part as the town itself was heavily bombarded. Eventually, Sebastopol fell, but the delay disrupted Hitler's timetable for conquest. Before many months, a complete and humiliating withdrawal from the Caucasus was underway. By this time, the tide of battle was running inexorably against Hitler. And the fall of Stalingrad in early 1943, with the loss of an entire German army, marked a crucial and irreversible turning point in his fortunes. Yet he still commanded enormous force in the field and resolved that the Germans would fight a trial of strength with the Red Army. The Soviets were entrenched around the city of Kursk. In Berlin, the German General Staff began planning Operation Citadel, a huge pincer attack intended to cut off the Kursk salient. By now, the Soviet commanders were well acquainted with their enemy's methods and correctly anticipated the coming attack. Both the military and civilian population threw themselves into desperate preparations. The Germans had been increasingly alarmed at the quantity and quality of the new Soviet armor. Some Stukas were therefore adapted specifically for use against tanks. One of these was flown by Hans Rudel, who now embarked on an extraordinary campaign as a tank destroyer. The tank buster version was equipped with two 37mm flak 18 armor-piercing cannons slung under the wings, and proved highly successful. Its distinctive appearance soon earned it the nickname Stuka mit den langen Stangen, or more graphically, der Panzernacker, the tank cracker. Rudel destroyed over 500 enemy tanks in his machine. Fittingly, the last surviving Stuka is also a tank buster, although the two underwing cannons have since been lost. After some delay to allow delivery of the latest German tanks, Operation Citadel began in early July. Hitler knew that never again would Germany be able to assemble a force on the scale deployed at Kursk. He knew, too, that his enemy was all the time growing stronger. He told his generals, "My stomach churns at the thought of this battle, but I see no alternative." Impressed by the earlier achievements of the Stuka, the Soviets had successfully deployed their own dive bombers and ground attack aircraft. The Stukas were frequently frustrated by the dense cloud of dust and smoke hanging over the battlefield, and by intense Soviet anti-aircraft fire. But when conditions allowed, the Stuka tank busters showed themselves formidably effective, claiming up to 60 Soviet machines destroyed in one day. In a single action, Rudel knocked out an entire column of 12 tanks. Yet, it was not nearly enough. The battle raged for nearly 50 days. Despite their vulnerability, the Stukas were still able to operate, being continually sent in to bolster threatened sections of the front. The Luftwaffe committed every available aircraft, however obsolete, to the fray, because there was nothing else. Slowly, and at stupendous cost, the war in the East was lost. The airmen were paying a heavy price for the complacency and misjudgments of Göring. Italy, the Western Allies were fighting a grim, costly, and slow-moving campaign against a masterfully organized defense. The German general, Kesselring, was a former Luftwaffe commander, and when in January 1944 the Allies landed an amphibious force behind German lines at Anzio, Kesselring's response was swift and effective. In repeated attacks, German Stukas swooped down relentlessly, striking the Allied troops and ships. Heavy German reinforcements were quickly deployed, and the expeditionary force was very nearly driven back into the sea. And yet, the shortcomings of the German strategic planning were now laid bare. This surprise appearance was to be the last successful deployment of the Stuka. The tide had turned emphatically in favor of the Allied forces, who now enjoyed overwhelming command in the air. The airspace was virtually impenetrable to the best and fastest Luftwaffe fighters, let alone the slow and clumsy Stukas. After the D-Day landings in June 1944, Allied Typhoons and Mustangs, armed with bombs, cannon, and rockets, came in low and fast, homing in on targets before the defenders were aware they were under attack. In the 3 weeks of the invasion, they dropped 12,500 tons of bombs on airfields and communications alone. 3 years previously, the Luftwaffe Stukas and bombers had dealt fearful destruction to the retreating Red Army. Now the German armies were to suffer unsparing devastation from the air in far greater measure. With the coming of 1945, the long war drew to an end, as Germany was crushed between the might of the Western Allies and the vast and ruthless Red Army. Although Nazi Germany was in its death throes, the bitter struggle went on. Short of pilots, mechanics, and planes, the Luftwaffe still flew. No more Stukas were built and production ceased in October 1944, but the surviving aircraft in the hands of men like Rudel flew on, still doing their duty in the face of overwhelming odds. By April 1945, the Red Army was poised for invasion of Germany itself. The Oder and Neisser rivers were the last barriers on the Soviet road to Berlin. Under cover of a huge artillery barrage, Soviet engineers constructed Bailey bridges across the two great waterways. Against this tempting target, the last Stukas flew wearily into their final battle, a desperate attempt to destroy the bridges. For the last time, the trumpets of Jericho sounded, but the mission was a failure, and the Soviet forces surged across the bridges and onto Berlin. It was the proud claim of the Stuka men that where the infantry went, so did the Stukas. And as the remnants of Hitler's forces were destroyed, the Stukas at last fell silent. Standing in a quiet corner of the Royal Air Force's museum at Hendon, Britain's only Stuka has a chunky, almost friendly profile. Difficult now perhaps to visualize that in the air the distinctive cranked wing shape gave the aircraft the appearance of an evil bird of prey plunging to strike its victim. obsolete when the war began, but in the right conditions and flown by the right men, the Stuka repeatedly demonstrated that it was one of the most lethal and feared weapons in the annals of war.